Hey guys, what's going on? This is Seth from REtipster.com. In this video, I wanted to show you a trick you can use with Redfin to pull in a lot of data and make it a little bit easier to figure out what land values are. And this trick I'm going to show you works in a lot of places, but not every place. And in the places where it doesn't work, I want to show you a little workaround on how to deal with that. And just to be totally upfront, this is not my idea. I actually learned about this several years ago from Karl James. He's a member of the REtipster community. And I thought it was a brilliant way to use the free information online to figure this out. And I also learned about the workaround I'm going to show you from another member of the community, Todd Millen. So none of this is my genius. This is just the genius of other people in the community. And I wanted to make sure you guys understood how to do it as well. So just to show you how this works, I'm going to go to Lake Las Vegas, Nevada to explain the process. Okay, so we go here. And first thing you're going to see is a map like this with some other property listings over here on the right. It might look like this with some actual photos, depending on how you have it set up. And first thing we want to do is we want to filter the properties that show up based on the types of properties we are looking at. And in this scenario, we're just looking at the vacant land properties. So we're going to click on home type and then click land and done. And what that's going to do is eliminate any houses or other types of properties that are not appropriate comparables. And if we wanted to take this further, we could go to all filters, and we could go as far as like specifying the lot size. Say, for example, if we wanted to go no less than 0.25 acres to 5 acres in this example. And this really just depends on the property that you are trying to value. If the property you're looking at is 10 acres, then I wouldn't filter this the way that I'm doing here. I'd probably shoot for the 5 to 10 to 15, 20 acre range, not this smaller range that doesn't really apply. And then also over here with this drop down, by default, it's going to show you the ones that are for sale. But another thing you can do is click on sold. And when it comes to trying to figure out the value of a property, this is almost always the better way to go, because this is not just some seller or realtor's opinion of what a property is worth. This is what these properties actually sold for. And we could go back 6 months, we could go back a year. It kind of depends on how many comps are showing up here. If you're seeing like none of them, you could go back 2 or 3 years, but just be aware that the further back you go, the less relevant those numbers are going to be, because property values can change from 1 year to another. And sometimes they can change pretty quickly. So in this case, I'm seeing there seems to be plenty of comps within the past 1 year. So I'm going to stick with that. And if I was working in a market where there just weren't that many comps based on the sold price, I could go with the for sale listings and just settle with that. I would just want to be aware that these are not actual sold prices. So when I start taking these into account to try to figure out what my property is worth, I would probably want to factor in some kind of discount by maybe 20 or 30%, simply to account for the fact that just because these are listed at these numbers doesn't mean they're actually going to sell at these numbers. Whereas with sold comps, this is literally what they sold for. But again, in this case, I'm seeing what I think is probably enough sold comps to work with. And a really nice thing about Redfin that none of these other listing sites will allow you to do is you can just go ahead and download all of these properties in a spreadsheet. And the reason this is such a big deal is because once you're able to download these, now you have some data that you're able to analyze and crunch some numbers and figure out what are these vacant lots selling for on average on a per acre basis. So first of all, we're going to go through here and just remove all the stuff that doesn't really matter. So I'm going to highlight all these rows and just delete them. And beds and baths obviously doesn't even apply because we're talking about vacant land. And really all I'm trying to do here is eliminate everything except for two columns, the price that it sold for and the lot size. Go ahead and delete all this stuff. Now, keep in mind, depending on what you are trying to figure out, you may want to use some of this data for other purposes. But again, all I'm trying to do is figure out the average sale price per acre over the past year in this area. And when it says lot size here, what Redfin is doing is it is telling you the square feet of the lot. It's not telling you the acres of the lot. So we're going to create a couple columns here so we can figure this out and get this into numbers that are a lot more usable for our purpose. So we're going to add acres. And we're going to add dollars per acre. And when it comes to acres here, so what we do is we just put this little formula in here. And the formula is equals. And then we're going to click on this cell right here and then divide it by 43560, because there are 43,560 square feet within every acre. And what this is going to do is it's going to tell us the exact acreage of these properties based on the amount of square feet. I'm going to get rid of some of these decimals here. And once we have this formula in here, we can just click this little dot in the lower right hand corner and drag it all the way down here. and is going to copy that same formula over to all of these. So now we can see the exact acreage of each one of these lots. And next up in this cell over here, where it says dollars per acre, we're gonna put equal sign, and we're going to click on this price that it sold for divided by the number of acres. And what this tells us is how much this property sold for on a per acre basis. Again, we can click this and drag it all the way down. And now we can see the price per acre on all these properties. And what we can do at this point is put a little equal sign in here and then type out the word average in all caps, and then open parentheses, and then we're going to click and drag all the way down here to include all these, and then close parentheses. And now what we're seeing down here is the average price per acre that these properties sold for based on all these comps. Now the thing to remember is that vacant land can be a pretty squirrely type of property to value, because a lot of times a vacant lot is one of a kind. Like, there really aren't any apples to apples comparables in that same market. In this case, we're fortunate because there are a lot of comparables that are very similar size in this particular market, so it makes it a lot more feasible. But even if that wasn't the case, it would still be helpful to see something about what vacant land is selling for in this area. And I think a lot of times what I might do is, if I did see some outliers in here, like sometimes when I look at this kind of situation, I might see all these numbers that look, you know, relatively similar, and then out of the blue, I'll see one that sold for like $7,000 an acre instead of a million. And in my mind, that's an outlier. I'm not sure why the price was so different, but for some reason, it's way off from the rest. And it's probably because there was some kind of issue with that property, or maybe it was a transaction between friends or family members or something like that. But whatever the reason, that's what I consider an outlier. So in those cases, if I see one that just doesn't make any sense and doesn't line up at all with the other ones on this list, I'll just delete it from the running so that I don't take that into consideration and it throws everything else off. So that's how this process works in Redfin. When everything is working correctly, when you find a property that has enough comps, and it does allow you to download the list like this. But the interesting thing about Redfin is that in some counties, it doesn't give you this option to download this Excel file. Like, for example, if I go up here to Costilla County, Colorado, and we do this same kind of thing, when we scroll down to the bottom here, we can see that that button to download this as a spreadsheet isn't there. So what do we do now, right? Well, this is something that I learned about from Todd, is that there are these data scrapers you can get that will basically crawl this site for you, so that once you have everything filtered out just the way you want it, it'll scan through it and put all this stuff into a spreadsheet for you. And it might not look as pretty, but you can still get all the same information this way. So the data scraper that Todd recommended was this one called Instant Data Scraper. And once you have it installed in your Chrome browser, you'll be able to see this icon right up here. And there's actually a lot of similar free extensions like this out there. I know Sean Callahan from the community mentioned that he uses this one, which I haven't even used yet, but apparently this does pretty much the same thing. And there's several others out there, but sometimes they can get a little confusing to understand what you're even doing. So I'm just going to show you how to do this in Redfin with this particular one. So all we have to do is click on this thing, and it's going to bring up this window right here. And what it's telling you right here is what it sees on the page and what it's going to crawl and put into a spreadsheet for you. And you might notice this thing right here that says locate the next button. So you'll see over here on Redfin, there are 296 results here, and only 40 of them are shown on this first page. So what that means is this data scraper can go beyond this first page to pull everything in if you want it to. And all you have to do is tell it where the next button is, so it understands how to get to that next page. So what we would do is click this locate next button. And we're going to scroll down here, and this arrow right here is the next button. We don't want to hit this, because then it's just going to go to that one page. But this right here is what we're going to want to hit. And so now that it knows where that next button is, we can click start crawling, and it's going to go through all these things and start pulling together this data for us, just as if that download button was there, even though it's not. And I'll show you what this looks like when it's all finished. And while this is going, you can see what it's doing right here, how long it's been working on it, how many pages it's scraped, how much information's been collected. Okay, so it took a little bit of time to pull all that data in, because there were a lot of listings to pick from in this case. But now that it's all done, it's scraped everything. All we have to do is download this as either a CSV file or a XLSX file, which is like the Excel format. Either one works. I'm gonna go with CSV here. Let's go ahead and open this thing up. Okay, so this is the file that was downloaded. And as you can see, like the headings aren't quite as clear, but essentially what we're gonna do here is the exact same thing we did before, where we're just looking for two columns here. We're looking for the sale price and we're looking for how many acres it is. And we can see this looks like it's the sale price right here, this column. And then this is the amount of acres for each property as well. And there's other data we could use for other things if we had a use for it, but I'm just gonna delete everything except for those two that we need. Let's go ahead and remove this stuff. And get rid of this. And there we go. I'm gonna just quick rename this just so I'm clear on what I'm looking at. And since the acreage is already here, we only have to create one new column now. So dollars per acre. And one interesting thing about this is that it's a little bit messier than we want it because we don't actually want the words acres and then lot in parentheses in these columns. We just want the number by itself so we can really easily do this calculation. A really easy way to get rid of that is to simply highlight all these things all the way down to the bottom. And then in Excel, we're gonna go up here to find and select. And essentially what we're gonna do is use the find and replace function. What this is going to do is it's going to highlight all the areas that say the words we don't want it to say. And we can say every time you see that, Excel, I want you to replace it with this. And in this case, we're just going to replace it with nothing because we don't want it there. So I'm going to go ahead and replace all. You can see it just made 310 replacements. And over here, those unwanted words are now gone. And it looks like in a few cases here, when it was less than an acre, it just used the word acre singular. So we got to do this again like that, and then do the same thing. There we go. So we got rid of all of the words. And now it's just a matter of putting in that same formula here. So we can go equals and then sale price divided by acres. And we'll go ahead and make these dollars just to make that clear. And then again, we can just take this thing and drag it all the way down and apply this same formula everywhere. There we go. And then we'll make this a little bit bigger so we can read all these numbers. And it looks like this one, wow. So this would be an example of an outlier. I don't know why that number's so high for this amount of acreage, but whatever the reason, this probably is not a good comp. And if I hadn't deleted all that information, I could go back and look this up and verify, but this right here is enough for me to know this probably is not considered an average property. So I'm gonna go ahead and delete this. And let's see here, this one looks like an outlier as well. Delete that one, and looks like this one too. Again, if I took the time to look closer at these outliers and understand why they're so different, that could be pretty enlightening and informative just because it would help me understand, how different is this from the subject property that I am looking at? And this is totally at your discretion to decide whether or not you want to remove any of these outliers, but this is just what I'm doing in this example. So let's go down here and do that same average formula, highlight all these things. And there you go. Now we have an average dollars per acre in this particular county. Now, something else you'll find with Redfin if you work in enough markets is that some markets, Redfin literally doesn't work in at all. And I'm not really sure why, but I'll just show you an example from a random county here in Alabama. So if we try to search here, it'll just say, sorry, Redfin isn't in Tallapoosa County yet. So we're out of luck. So if you run into this with Redfin, an alternative is to go over here to LandWatch and do the exact same thing. And this data scraper works the exact same way. So we can go ahead and check this out. And LandWatch is a pretty different site from Redfin because it's, for the most part, just targeting land people. And because of that, you'll see different types of filtering options to choose from. And you might honestly want to even start with LandWatch instead of Redfin, depending on what you're trying to do. But once you get these filtering criteria set however you want it to work, it works pretty much the same way, where you just go up here, and then you can start crawling, and it's going to pull out a lot of the same information. And the output that you get, this actual file, is going to look a little bit different. Let's just show you really quickly how this thing looks. So it's similar to when we got this from Redfin. It looks kind of messy and these headings aren't really helpful, but we can't see dollar amounts in acres, and that's really what matters. And one thing I didn't do here that I should have done before I ran the scraper was making sure it was only going to include sold comps. So I've already kind of messed this up and not gone about it correctly. But my point here is just to let you know, LandWatch should work just as well for you. And some of you might be wondering about Zillow. And for whatever reason, at the time of this recording, Zillow actually isn't the best fit for this because they don't consider consistently put acreages in those listings. So a lot of times the acres won't be included. Maybe that's going to change at some point in the future, but really for the purpose of what we're trying to do here, having that acres number in the sold number and having enough of those comps to work with is really key to this working. And Zillow kind of makes that a little bit harder. So that's why I kind of start with Redfin and throw LandWatch out there as well. Just want to at least give you a couple different options to work with. So thanks again for watching. I wish you all the best in trying to figure out land values wherever you're working, and I'll talk to you next time.